Hi guys. It's always difficult to take stage after Nandan and Mr. Kant. This is like from huge visionary statements coming down on the ground and then talking about
the gift has to be those books.
Yep. Let me also know which books you choose.
Nandan's book. Rebooting India.
Yep. So what we do, we really try to entertain people. After health, education, infrastructure, digital stack, APIs, a lot of high-sounding words which are really important and which have been really essential for our growth, we as human beings also need entertainment. A little bit of smile on our faces really goes a long way. And smile which we create for ourselves and we create for others. And I think that's what our company's aims to do. We just generally create smile on people, and you would have seen around you and yourself when you are playing mobile game, when you are kind of really doing an interactive entertainment, it really kind of brings you alive. The kid in you, it really comes out. And I think that's what we really enjoy. We just keep playing and that's our job. That's what I say when a young intern is joining us. Hey, listen, just go take a couple of phones, sit on a bean chair, and just play. He said, is that my job? I said, yes, precisely, that's your job. Just go and play. So that's what we are. And can I have the clicker, please? Yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to very quickly take you through who we are for some of the more numbers-oriented people who would like to look at anybody very rationally, objectively. Yeah. So Nitish founded it in 1999. We are Mumbai-based. We are the largest by revenue and profit, the largest gaming company in India. We did some numbers. We were lucky. We were hard work. A lot of pieces of puzzle came together. I'm not going to rattle it off. There are some nice, interesting numbers for a lot of LPs of Mani and team, which would like to kind of look at this. Yeah. Since our DRHP is out, we were happy to share this. Otherwise, in most of the conferences I have seen people asking me these numbers, I would have said sorry. So yes, they are numbers for the first time in front of any external audience. We have spread across emerging markets. So we are not just bringing smiles in India, we're bringing smiles across Africa, Middle East, Southeast Asia, Indian subcontinent. We love traveling, both me and Nitish keep moving, looking at new geographies, new people, new cultures, and this is what you see our whole operations really kind of spread across. We love, as I said, making games, making people entertain. We work with partners. We have done our licenses of Chota Beam from Green Gold, Virat Kohli, Motu Patlu from Viacom, Hrithik Roshan, RCB, Augie. So we really believe what audiences are seeing around them, how can we really bring them one more frontier of entertainment, and that's what it is. Again, some numbers for people who love to know. The moot point is we have a lot of people, we have a lot of users, and we are entertaining a lot of people every day. And we will continue to doing that. With the internet revolution happening in India, we have seen huge amount of explosion in gamers, and which is reflecting it in our own numbers. So yes, as I said, for a successful company, a lot of things have to come around. And digital stack being built by Nandan and the whole infrastructure push being given by government, I think this is just the start. We love to create network of companies. We are fortunate to have a lot of our founders who trust in us, who believe in us, and who have been nice enough to let us be part of their journey. And this is a small network of us. We believe that Indian ecosystem is going to see many, many more startups. And that's what Nazara is really looking at them, providing them the able partnership for them to grow, for us to grow, for the whole ecosystem to grow. Yes, we have really delivered a lot of value to the investors. Westbridge invested roughly around $3 million a decade and plus back. They've already kind of in cashed $80 million, and IPO is still to happen, and they have a considerable holding, 20 plus, in the company. So they must be a happy camper. I have no doubt about it. Yeah, But all this is fine. I just want to kind of invite Nitish. He's the guy who made it happen. I'm just a conveyor of a message for you. Nitish, the stage is for you. Yeah.
Hi everyone. Is it working now? Hi everyone. Thanks Manish for the intro. So let me just jump right in. You know, I come from a quick introduction. I come from a textile family background, but never understood cloth or cotton. My father introduced me to what I will introduce you to, my first love. And as they say, you know, first love is often hard to forget. Here I am 30 years later, still haven't forgotten, still chasing my first love, which was this, a ZX Spectrum. So I was 6 years old and my dad gifted me this ZX Spectrum. And I was completely hooked to that, you know, the games that you could play on this, the games that you could make. So I actually coded my first game when I was 7 years old. And that's what I'm doing now 30 years later as well. I wanted to also kickstart this presentation with this slide. And it's kind of a quiz for you guys for the next few minutes to think what's the common pattern or what links these three, one famous Indian movie star and two famous sports stars. As I go along, I'll introduce or help you find the connection. So, you know, I got into computers, technology and gaming at a very early age. And then I was studying in Mumbai, doing my BCom. Come from a Marwadi business family, so normally you do your BCom, you know, study at Sydenham College, go for an MBA in the US, come back and join dad's business. That's set, right? And that's the path I was on. But I still continue to be very interested in computers and technology, and this was the early 90s. The internet was really starting to come in. I was running my own bulletin board service in my bedroom, which had like, you know, 20 computers and 40 modems and all of that. So I was kind of getting more and more immersed into computers and technology. And then I actually chanced upon making good friends with nobody else than Mr. Shami Kapoor, who was at that point of time in the early 90s, kind of the pioneer of internet in India. He was kind of leading it. And the kind of passion you just saw with Mr. Nilekani or Mr. Kant, he used to exude that same passion for the early days of internet, right? And I was completely mesmerized. He, went on to be my mentor for a very long time till he passed away. But I spent a lot of time at his home in his computer, Mac Den, almost twice a month, talking about computers and internet and entertainment and technology. And perhaps I now, in retrospective, feel that, you know, those days really brought about the want or the aspiration to, you know, get into this as a business. So I was still studying in Sydenham College when I actually thought of starting something in gaming. From an Indian market perspective, I would see a lot of my college friends, you know, play computer games with each other. And I thought there should be a potential in that business. I didn't realize it was like 20 years too early. I was starting 15 years too early, but I started nevertheless. So while I started this in 2000, it was probably also one of the worst timings to start, right? I started a dot-com in January of 2000. And as we all know, March of 2000, you had the massive dot-com crash. After that, 2-3 years, I spent doing the most expensive MBA that even Harvard would not offer, right? I had lost like 3-4 crore rupees and I spent 2-3 years trying to, you know, earn that money back. So I learned a lot of lessons, and those lessons are something I'm going to share right now. These have worked for us, these have worked for Nazara, may not necessarily work for everyone, may not necessarily be apt in today's times, but I'm still happy to share some of them. So one thing I decided after the dot-com crash is that, you know, I'll go back to doing business as it's originally meant to be, right? You learn business definition, which is an activity to make profit. Sometimes we forget that. During dot-coms, I also forgot that, but I kind of went back to that. So I said, come what may, I will only do the business for profit, not for some vanity metrics to chase. And over the years, that has worked for us, because the business we were in, the gaming business, it was very early days. And had we kept chasing vanity metrics, we would have never sustained for so long. By chasing profits, we've been able to persevere. I think the other thing we decided to do was stay in sync with market reality. So like, I'm coming from South Bombay, grew up playing consoles, PC games. It would be very easy to try and build maybe, a really high-end game, which would not be suitable for the market in terms of, bandwidth constraints, etc. So we tried to always be in sync with market reality, not get too ahead of ourselves. VR, for example, is today a good example, right? While we are doing some R&D in it, we haven't over-invested in it because we still feel monetization is a bit away. So we try to be at the edge, but not kind of bleed at the cutting edge. Business evolution. So over the years, we have, found ways to monetize and evolve the company. This is when the second person on my, this comes in, right? So in 2004, 2005, when we had stabilized as a company, I'll share a small anecdote. We wanted to, kind of work with some of the large mobile telcos. And we were a very small company and finding a difficult time to get into contract with them, relation with them. So we decided, we thought, gaming, let's do something big locally. We thought cricket is very big in India. Who's the biggest star in India? This is 2004, obviously Sachin Tendulkar. Let's go and make a game around Sachin Tendulkar. So we connected with Worldtel, his agents then. Took 6 months of chasing them to get a meeting with Sachin, right? And I remember this meeting with him at his house in 2004. He met me and he said, all this is good. My minimum fees are $1 million. If you're willing to sign up, I'm happy to sign up. And I kind of said, the best I can afford is $10,000. And it's kind of an awkward moment at that point of time. But luckily for me, we closed the deal at $30,000. So it wasn't bad. But I think the bigger thing for Sachin, of course, was more the technology and the connect with youth, which is what he did it for, not for $30,000. But for us, for me and for the company, it was a big break because, one, we got a big credibility with Sachin coming on board. Airtel and Vodafone, that time MaxTouch, all signed up with us very quickly. But also, we got some unexpected media publicity. The unexpected media publicity, I remember being featured on CNBC Young Turks then, was seen by Sandeep Singhal at Westbridge. And the next morning in my office, I had a note saying there was a call from a Mr. Singhal from Westbridge. And I didn't know what VCs meant at that point of time. But that's also what led to our funding, which was, for $1.5 million then. For us, 2005, $1.5 million was a lot. Dollar was 40 rupees. It was 6 crore rupees. But, it kind of really helped the company get a cash flow, which it didn't have for a long time. So that's how we've evolved over the years. Thereafter, we went on to build, the right kind of partnerships that helped us. So we didn't try and do everything ourselves. We partnered with Electronic Arts, which was one of the world's, or is one of the world's biggest gaming companies. Brought them to India, took them to many other markets over the years, to Africa, Middle East, and it was a fantastic door opener for us. And we didn't have to invest, and we didn't even have the capability to invest in making those kind of games that we could bring to market with this partnership. So I think the right kind of partnerships at the right time have also helped us, whether it is Sachin, whether it is Electronic Arts or others that we have done. With quick POCs and rapid scaling, so just to give you an example, today we operate in 61 countries, all emerging market countries. We have, India is a very competitive, low ARPU market. And once you've been able to build a profitable business here, I figured it would be pretty easy to kind of replicate it in many similar markets with similar demographics. So today we do a lot of POCs here in India and scale them across the board. And also, how are we building leadership in our company? One thing that's been strange to me and strange at Nazara is we've never really paid over the market rate. Neither have we ever had, and this is an honest confession, had very fancy HR practices. Remember, I just did my BCom at Sydenham, right? I wasn't educated in Harvard. So, but even then, almost our entire CXO team, almost our entire second tier team has been working for us for a decade or more. And in our business, that kind of longevity is very difficult, but it's a huge asset. I think today at Nazara, it's a huge asset because we work in 60 countries. And this team that has been with us for 10 years really understands the company's DNA, the business, and you know, I got so many people who are traveling all over the world making this expand. And I figured to myself over the years that it's actually the fact that we have been a very profitable company for a long time. Month on month, stability for the team is there. Gradual growth is there. That is what has helped us retain them and build this asset for ourselves. Capital efficiency is something I can speak for a couple of hours if you guys are interested. I'm a Marwadi, for those who understand, and it's in our blood, right? But capital efficiency, I think, is also from the dot-com days and the experience of the dot-com, that you know every rupee matters and we have to respect every rupee. Even today, we do that. And that's what I also showed Muhammad Ali earlier, right? One quote of Muhammad Ali that's always been close to me and ingrained into the DNA of the company is float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. So we build our entire business to be very asset light so that we can float like a butterfly. We don't understand very capital intensive businesses, and we try and be as capital efficient as we can be. Delivering value for investors. So for me personally, investors have always been a huge moral responsibility once they've come in. I had three investors that came in as angels right in January of 2000, just 2 months before the dot-com crash happened. At that point of time, my company had zero revenue, but they still valued it at $5 million and put in maybe $100,000 of investment. But delivering even for them has been a very important part of it. So, you know, when we raised money with Westbridge, and that was at a lower valuation because it was post-dot-com crash, we kind of issued additional shares to these angel investors to bring them down to the level of Westbridge. There was no written commitment to it, but I think delivering value for them was important for us. And I think that is today proven because today, as we are trying to go public, Manish tried a lot, my CEO here, to convince these angel investors to sell out, and all three of them refused to sell even one single share. So that makes us pretty proud. Of course, Westbridge has been a great investor for us, very patient, 12 years, and hopefully we've delivered value for them. Another important point for us has been goodwill, so working closely with the ecosystem. Yeah. One thing I'm very proud about is Nazara, in its 17 years of existence, has not ever fought a legal case with anybody, either something that we put on someone or someone that put on us. And the thinking has been, it's not that issues don't happen, but we've always preferred to focus on, you know, using that time to devote into positive energy rather into get. So I think the goodwill has helped us a lot over the years. 17 years and the journey has just begun. The topic Vani said was the dawn of exits. I would say for us, the IPO, potential IPO, is, you know, a new beginning, a dawn of a new beginning. So we're keeping our fingers crossed for the next few years to build this company into a large MNC in this space. Thank you very much.